Welcome to this afternoon's session on winding up Cayman and BVI companies. Grateful for you all coming here, particularly with the bomb scare. Hopefully we're past all that. And also very conscious that you've got a psychoanalysis of Donald Trump taking place next door. And I'm afraid winding up BVI and Cayman companies is inherently less interesting than the Donald, but we will do our best to keep you informed, if not entertained. My name is Guy Manning. I am a litigation partner at Campbell's in the Cayman Islands. I've been doing insolvency litigation for 17 years now, the last 11 of which have been in Cayman. Joining me on the panel today, we have a BVI lawyer, a Cayman liquidator, and a BVI liquidator to give you the full perspective on both jurisdictions. Immediately to my left is Russell Crumpler. Russell is our BVI liquidator on the panel today. And he has led KPMG's restructuring practice in the BVI for the last 5 years, and in the course of that has acted on some of the highest profile formal insolvencies in the jurisdiction. These include Titan Group, the Topco of China's largest private oil and gas storage company, Victory Life, which is the BVI's first ever regulated insurance company, which ran afoul of the BVI regulator, and Peak Hotels, a significant minority investor in the Aman Hotels chain that's been embroiled in litigation and fraud claims. To Russell's left is my partner, Callum McNeil. Callum is also an insolvency litigator based in our Campbell's British Virgin Islands office. He began his career in his home country of Australia, and like most Australians, he's travelled around a lot, and in the course of doing so has acquired a wealth of offshore experience, firstly in the Cayman Islands, then Guernsey, and then for the last 4 years in the BVI. And last but by no means least, at the end, is Hugh Dixon. Hugh is our Cayman liquidator on the panel today. He's a partner with Grant Thornton, and although based in Cayman, he has responsibility for GT's worldwide offshore financial services restructuring practice, and has covered offshore jurisdictions ranging from the Caribbean through to Asia, and even in the Indian Ocean territories. Hugh's been working with distressed companies and restructuring for over 30 years, including spells as varied as supervising South African Airways to recent major insolvency cases such as Stanford International Bank. The basic plan today is for myself and Callum to start things off by giving a brief overview of the mechanisms for getting Cayman and BVI companies into liquidation. And we're going to be looking at some recent important judgments in both jurisdictions, relating principally to winding up petitions presented by the companies themselves, by shareholders and by creditors. We'll then move to the post-appointment phase, and Russell and Hugh will talk us through some of their experiences on key issues regularly faced by Cayman and BVI liquidators when winding up companies in cross-border liquidations. Conscious that we've got a bit of a mixed audience today, some of you very familiar with offshore liquidations and the law, others perhaps less so, please feel free to jump in at any time, either with questions or with any comments from your own experience. We'll be happy to deal with those. So just to start things off, the vast majority of winding up petitions, both in Cayman and BVI, are presented by one of three parties. That would be either the company itself, the shareholders, or the creditors. And we're going to focus on those three types of petition today. I just note briefly, there is in both jurisdictions a fourth category of petitioner. That in Cayman is the Cayman Islands Monetary Authority, which has standing to present a winding up petition in respect of any company which is carrying on a regulated business on the grounds that it's not licensed or registered to do so, or for any other reason in the regulatory laws. And the BVI, the Financial Services Commission, essentially has the same role in relation to regulated businesses there and can petition on public interest grounds. As does the Attorney General, albeit in relation to any company at all. So we're not going to really cover those types of petition today. They are few and far between, and therefore there's a very sort of small body of case law on those types of petitions. So we're going to have a look first at company petitions, and starting with the Cayman Islands, which I'll cover before moving on to Callum to deal with the BVI. Now, a Cayman Islands company can petition on any of the grounds set out in the company's law. There's a variety of those, but in practice, if a company's going to petition, it's always on the basis of inability to pay debts, the company's insolvency. And in Cayman, they may do so for two reasons. One is that the business really has come to the end of the road and it needs to be wound up and placed into official liquidation. The other is where they'll petition and simultaneously apply for the appointment of provisional liquidators with a view to promoting a restructuring of the company's affairs. And if that restructuring is successful, then the petition would be dismissed and the company would emerge from the process with the restructured debt and possibly a restructured capital structure. So far so good, but Cayman law has been thrown into a bit of a state of flux recently by a decision at the back end of last year called China Shanshui Cement Group Limited, which goes to the question of the circumstances in which the directors of a company actually have the power to present the winding up petition in the company's name. Now, until 2009, the position in Cayman had been clear. It followed the old English position in a case called Riemadart, which said that the directors only had standing to petition if they were either expressly authorised to do so by the articles, which most articles in my experience rarely do, or they had the authority of a shareholder's resolution. Now, this was problematic in practice because you've got an insolvent company, the shareholders may have no interest in having it wound up, they could well be out of the money, but without their consent, the directors can't actually do anything to get the company into liquidation. You know, unless it may be that a creditor would act, but the directors have fiduciary duties in that situation to have regard to the interests of the creditors, but they're hamstrung by the need to go to the shareholders for consent. So very unsatisfactory, and the position had been resolved in England by statutory amendment, which allowed the directors to present the petition in their own name rather than in the name of the company. That seems to work well. There was an attempt to change the law in Cayman. You'd think it would be a simple process, but something went wrong with the drafting of the legislation. It came before the courts in 2011, and before Mr. Justice Jones, who acknowledged that the law wasn't drafted the way it should have been, but construing the legislation as a whole, effectively found a way around this to achieve the commercial result we needed in Cayman, which was to say that as long as the company was insolvent, then the directors were free to petition regardless of what the articles said and regardless of what the shareholders said. Sensible commercial result, that's where we needed to get to. But it was always a bit of a sticking plaster over the problem with the legislation. That case was unopposed. It came back before the court at the end of last year in China Cement on an opposed application where the shareholders sought to have the petition struck out on the basis that they hadn't authorised the directors to present it. This was a restructuring case where there were notes due to default, and the company wanted to have provisional liquidators put in to try and restructure the debt. Shareholders opposed that and were successful in doing so. They persuaded the judge, Justice Mangatal, that Justice Jones had got it wrong in China Milk, and that unless you have a power in the articles or a shareholder resolution, you cannot petition as directors. So we now have two conflicting decisions on this point, but because the second decision was an opposed application, and there's a reasoned judgment, the court's very likely to follow that latter decision, which is a significant problem in the jurisdiction currently for the restructuring market and how you deal with restructurings, because it's only the company that has standing to do it. A creditor can't seek the appointment of a restructuring liquidator. So that is a big problem right now in Cayman, but I'll hand over to Callum to say a word on the position of the BVI.
Thanks, Guy. The position in the BVI for company petitions is rather straightforward and follows the English position of Emadart, which is valid and binding authority in the BVI. The directors do not have the power to go ahead and petition. Guy covered the topics, the people that are entitled to bring a petition. So I'll move on now to shareholders, having dealt with companies. In shareholders, we have a right to petition, as you'd expect, a shareholder, a contributory, or a member, however you want to call them. However, where they petition on the grounds of insolvency, they need leave of the court. And the court will only give leave if there's a prima facie case that the company is insolvent. So that's a short point there. I'll just talk about no action clauses later on and contractual bars to people petitioning. But in the context of a shareholder petition, that you can't contract out of that. There's an old case from Victorian times, which is Peveril Gold Mines, That is, articles restraining a shareholder from petitioning will be invalid on public policy grounds because the legislation provides they have a right, can't contract out of that. That's 1898, and there's no recent authority considering that in the BBI, but that would be the position. Another ground for winding up a company on the just and equitable ground by a shareholder, another ground is just and equitable, which is a very broad approach to how you can go ahead and tell the court that the company should be wound up, not necessarily because it's insolvent. You'll probably remember back in 2010, 2011, there was a BVI versus Cayman divergence of authority between Justice Jones and Justice Bannister. Now, I won't go on very long about that because there's been so very many articles written about it and so many people sitting in places like this talking about it. But I'll just give you a quick refresher, and then Guy will give us an update on a recent case that regards the loss of substratum ground. Now, loss of substratum has always traditionally been that it's impossible for the company to carry out its objects, so therefore it should be wound up. Now, in Re Belmont Asset-Based Lending in 2010, Justice Jones held that it can be said that it is just and equitable to make a winding up order in respect of an open-ended corporate mutual fund if the circumstances are such that it has become impracticable, if not actually impossible. So there's a divergence right there from the long line of authority by Justice Jones. If it has become impracticable, if not actually impossible, to carry on its investment business in accordance with the reasonable expectations of its participating shareholders based on representations contained in its offering document. Now, having had the decision from Justice Jones, some of my peers in the BVI thought they'd try that, as you'll recall, in the BVI before Mr. Justice Bannister's court, who wasn't having any of it. The commercial judge, as he then was, Justice Bannister, considered the test developed by Justice Jones, and in Aeris Multi-Strategy Lending Fund and Quantech Opportunity, the judge declined to follow the new Cayman authority and held rather that a company, even if it is a fund, will not be wound up in BVI unless it has actually become impossible for it to achieve its objects. Merely being impractical for it to carry on will not suffice. This is simply because a fund seeks to wind down its affairs does not mean that it has lost its substratum. The fund can still hold its assets, buy them and sell them, so the company is still carrying on business. Therefore, since 2010, the law of Cayman and BVI have been divergent. However, there's a recent case I'll hand over to Guy in the Cayman Islands.
Yeah, thanks, Callum. Just before I deal with that case, which is a decision called Harbinger, just briefly on the standing point. In order to be a shareholder with standing to petition to wind up a Cayman company, there are a number of requirements. Firstly, you have to be the legal owner of the shares. You have to be the person on the register. You cannot be the beneficial owner alone. Your shares have to be at least partly paid up, and you must have either been originally allotted them or held them for at least 6 months. And that provision was introduced to stop so-called vulture funds buying up positions in Cayman companies to stir up trouble. And I think it has had that effect. It's been good at stopping those sorts of opportunistic petitions. But that is what you need to satisfy standing. The position is somewhat unclear on non-petition clauses and their enforceability as against shareholders. Previously, the position was, as Callum has said it, that any clause in the Articles of Association of a company which purport to restrict the shareholders' rights to petition would not be upheld. They were void on public policy grounds. Position is slightly uncertain now. We've had further changes to the legislation which expressly recognise that the court is required to dismiss or adjourn a petition if the petition is contractually bound not to present one. Vis-a-vis creditors, that's very clear. The court will uphold those. What is not clear is whether the legislature intended to override the old authorities and will now uphold non-petition clauses as against shareholders. So we'll have to wait to see for one of those to come before the court. But moving on to the Harbinger decision, which we've mentioned, we've seen, I think, the Cayman court starting to swing back towards the BVI and English position. Harbinger was a special purpose vehicle that was set up following the credit crunch in 2008, by a master feeder fund structure, and it was set up so that investors' shares in the fund could be compulsorily redeemed by the fund, and then in specie they were given shares in this new vehicle that had been set up. And that new vehicle then held shares in the master fund, and that bought the management time to wind down the portfolio and pay the investors out over time. They were supposed to have got all their money back by 2010. By 2015, most of the assets had been realized, but it still, process wasn't complete, and some investors ran out of patience and wanted liquidators appointed to finish the job. And they relied on the line of authority saying it had become impractical for this company to continue doing what it was doing. The judge, Justice Clifford, I think reading between the lines, clearly disagreed with Jones J's reasoning in the various cases, but rather than overrule him, he rather unsatisfactorily distinguished it on the basis that all of the previous Cayman decisions related to open-ended funds, this was not an open-ended fund, it was a special purpose vehicle set up by a fund, and actually there should be a different test. One test for funds, which is whether it's simply become impractical for the fund to carry on, and then for any other type of company, the test is whether it's actually become impossible for it to carry on. And there's no logical reason for that distinction. In my view, it's a dangerous road to go down to start trying to distinguish between different types of company purely on the basis of the business. But I think clearly the context of that was he did disagree with Justice Jones, but didn't feel perhaps bold enough to overrule him. So we will have to see where that goes next, whether that might get up to the Court of Appeal. It won't in Harbinger, but in another case. The one other point that emerged out of the Harbinger decision was the company tried to argue this company had a general objects clause in its memorandum of association, therefore it was capable of doing anything, therefore you could never say it was impossible for it to fulfill its object, because its object could be whatever it wanted it to be. Judge didn't like that argument and said, no, you always have to look actually at the evidence and find out what the real object of this company was, what it was actually doing, what the shareholders' reasonable expectations were that it was doing, and it's that object that you run the test against. So, yeah, interesting decision, and I say we'll have to see where that goes when it gets before the Court of Appeal eventually. But I will hand back now to Callum to take you quickly through some recent issues on creditor petitions in the BVI.
Thanks, Guy. So we've dealt with the company's right to petition, we've dealt with the shareholders' right, and in BVI the directors don't have that right. And now we turn to creditors' petitions. So a creditor in the BVI must be an actual or contingent creditor, and there are deeming provisions for insolvency if you don't answer a statutory demand. You're deemed to be insolvent if you have an execution of process that's been returned against you unsatisfied as a company, so if the enforcement doesn't work and you still owe the money. There's also the solvency test, and we have the two-pronged test, whereas the Cayman Islands does not. We have the cash flow test and we have the balance sheet test. So a debt cannot be paid. So a company will be insolvent if it cannot pay its debts as and when they fall due. But it's also clear in BVI that if the court discerns that debts that are falling due shortly or imminently can't be paid, then that will also suffice. So if it can't pay a debt that's due today, it's insolvent. If it can't pay a debt that's due in the next week or so, then that will also be insolvent, even though it's not presently due at that very moment. And the court will consider those sorts of debts in a very short time frame. But with the balance sheet insolvency, we have a much broader approach to what insolvency is in the BVI. This was recently considered by the Ultimate Appellate Court in England, the Supreme Court. Now, the judges of the Supreme Court, as you know, sit on the Privy Council, which is the BVI's Ultimate Appellate Court as well. So we've got an old decision, De La Sala and De La Sala from the Privy Council, letting us in the Commonwealth jurisdictions know that if the Supreme Court or the House of Lords, as it then was, says that something is binding and explains a legal principle, although we're not strictly bound by the Supreme Court, we should pay very careful attention to it because the judges come from the same board. With those thoughts in mind, balance sheet test in Eurosail in 2013, the court in that court clearly stated that it cannot be that all companies whose liabilities exceed their assets are insolvent, because every company would be insolvent, or almost every company. There needs to be a comparison of present and future liabilities, and there need to be discounts for contingencies and deferment. And a proper allowance must be had for those things. The more the distant liabilities, the harder it is to discern when a company will be able to pay its debts in the future, even where it can currently pay its debts. So in that case, there was a 30-year timescale for the payment of hundreds of millions of dollars of notes, and so it was that was far too, it was too often in the distance for the court to decide that the company was insolvent on that basis. And that would be the position in the BVI, because as I say, we have those two tests. So just thinking about contractual rights as well for creditors, when they might satisfy that they are a creditor, and it might be that the company can't pay its debts, but there might be also a contractual bar or no action clause. And in the BVI, whilst there's not direct authority on point, the common law position will hold, the creditor will be contractually barred from petitioning to wind up the company if it's made that bargain. I had a two-day hearing on that very issue in a matter called OAS last year, where waiting for a decision on it. That was a no action clause in notes, and the note holders petitioned when they had clearly had no right to because of the contract. However, we're yet to hear the decision in that, which is pending. So I think I'll just move on now to arbitration clauses in the context of winding up petitions. This is probably about as interesting as it's going to get from me. So I'll take you to the clearest example of divergence of authority between the BVI Court of Appeal and the English Court of Appeal. And bearing in mind that in BVI, we usually follow what's done in England and Wales, subject to local legislative changes and differences. But that changed in December. Now, England and BVI have both adopted the unsutral model law on arbitration. And when you go when you have an agreement and you have an arbitration clause in it, it will say, of course, well, if one party presents the matter for a dispute, for arbitration, then the proceedings in the court must not proceed. And that was the clause that was considered by the Court of Appeal in England and Wales recently in Salford, where the court held that it will not hear a winding up petition where there is an arbitration clause. The court held that whilst it does retain its discretion under the Insolvency Act to make a winding up order, notwithstanding the fact of the Arbitration Act, the court opined that in a winding up petition, save in exceptional circumstances that the court presently found it difficult to envisage, the court should exercise its discretion to wind up a company consistently with the legislative policy embodied in the Arbitration Act. So you've got these two acts sitting beside each other, and the Court of Appeal in England and Wales said, well, yes, I have discretion whether or not to wind it up, but I see that the Parliament has passed an Arbitration Act that says matters must be referred to arbitration, but the parties have agreed to it. I'm going to stop the petition from proceeding because the parties should deal with it in arbitration. And the court reasoned that if it didn't do that, the exercise, then the way would be left open to one party through the draconian threat of litigation to apply pressure on the alleged debtor to pay immediately. And that would be then facing the burden of resisting the winding up. So the court felt that it must stay, exercise its discretion to stay the winding up petition in Salford. Now, in BVI, we also have this almost identical wording in our Arbitration Act. But this is where the two courts part company, and this is only very recently. So the Court of Appeal in BVI held that while the arbitration clauses are designed to resolve disputes between contracting parties, the matter becomes an issue between the company and its creditors as a whole once the petition is presented in BVI. So a petition is no longer a fight between two people. It's a collective proceeding for the benefit of all creditors, and the Court of Appeal reasoned that for that very purpose, that the parties didn't get to resolve their dispute that way, the court would go ahead and consider the solvency or otherwise. The issue then becomes whether or not the company can pay its debts as they fall due, and we spoke about the solvency test. Now, the court in BVI said that the arbitration clauses don't have any impact at all when we're talking about these winding up petitions, which is rather extraordinary, because its sister, its brother court, only very recently beforehand said they do apply. The court said it would not grant an automatic stay simply because there's an issue in this clause. The creditor does not have to show exceptional circumstances to obtain the winding up order. The creditor in BVI only has to show that there is no genuine dispute on substantial grounds. Now, the court reasoned that the exercise of the discretion to wind up the company under the no genuine dispute test was too firmly ingrained in BVI law for the court to follow in Salford, in Peak Hotels to follow Salford. So, with that, I'd ask Guy if you'd like to pick up on the arbitration point.
Sure, yeah. I mean, just briefly in Cayman, I mean, the position in terms of standing to petition for creditors is fairly similar. If you're an actual a contingent or a prospective creditor, then you are entitled to petition to wind up a company. We do, however, have a different solvency test. The balance sheet is not relevant in Cayman, and the cash flow test is not forward-looking at all. You have to show that the company owes a debt which is presently due and payable and hasn't been paid either to you or to somebody else. So although you can have standing as a contingent creditor, at the time of the winding up hearing, you still got to show that there's a debt that's overdue. And without that, you can't get a winding up order. In terms of the arbitration clause provision, we've had a couple of Cayman judgments on this. And again, theme today, the law's in a bit of a state of flux. We have another first instance decision of Mr. Justice Jones called Cybernaut, which actually related to an exempted limited partnership rather than a company, but the rules are the same. In Cayman, it's the same same procedure. The issue there, certain limited partners petitioned to wind up the partnership, others resisted it. And there were a couple of issues. Those resisting it had argued that in the partnership agreement, that the parties had agreed to contract out of the statutory winding up procedure. They'd agreed a mechanism for winding up this partnership in the agreement, and that was binding, and therefore the court couldn't exercise its jurisdiction to wind up the partnership. Alternatively, if that wasn't right, there was in any event an arbitration clause, and they said because there was a dispute over whether it should be wound up, the right thing to do is to stay the petition, send the parties off to arbitration, and then depending on the outcome of that arbitral tribunal, potentially come back to have the partnership wound up at that stage. Justice Jones found, firstly on the facts, that the parties had not contracted out of the statutory winding up procedure. But he said even if he was wrong on that, the dispute between the parties was incapable, it was a type of dispute that was incapable of being arbitrated for two reasons. One, when the court makes a winding up order, it's an order in rem, which is capable of affecting third parties, and therefore it would not be appropriate to allow this dispute to be referred bilaterally as part of a bilateral dispute to an arbitral tribunal to rule on. And secondly, that the question of who should be appointed as liquidator of this partnership, because it was insolvent, was a matter of public interest, and again, wasn't something that an arbitrator could or should be determining. That was a matter for the exclusive jurisdiction of the court. So he then proceeded to make a winding up order. And he distinguished this case from the English cases because in the English cases, Fulham Football Club, they hadn't actually been seeking a winding up order. They'd been seeking relief for unfair prejudice. So that was the basis on which he found himself able to distinguish from the English cases, and essentially would have put Cayman in the same position as the BVI has found itself in at Court of Appeal level. However, the issue came before the Court of Appeal more recently in the Sphinx case. This was not a winding up petition. The Sphinx companies were already in liquidation. The issue there was that the liquidators were in a dispute with their own contingency fee lawyers in New York about whether contingency fees were payable under the contingency fee agreement, and the contingency fee agreement had an arbitration clause. The issue that arose in the liquidation proceedings was whether the liquidators had to make a reserve for the contingency fee lawyer's claim or whether they could go ahead and pay out the estate's assets to the shareholders. The shareholders said contingency fee lawyer's claims are hopeless, you can go ahead and pay us the money. Liquidators wanted to take a more cautious approach and make a reserve. So the issue was, was the arbitration clause binding within a liquidation proceeding? Could the court disregard it? The Court of Appeal found that the issues between the parties fell squarely within the terms of the arbitration agreement and what it was contemplated would be resolved by arbitration, and had no hesitation in staying the application by the shareholders so that the parties could go off and resolve the differences by arbitration. And then, you know, it would then revert back to the court once the outcome of that was known. Counsel in that case expressly invited the Court of Appeal to overrule Mr. Justice Jones' decision in Cybernaut so as to clarify the position. The Court of Appeal declined to do so because it said it wasn't necessary on the facts of the case, but it did describe his reasoning as debatable, which I think is a polite way of saying they disagreed with it. And I suspect if it does come back before the courts again, we will end up following the English position, not the BVI position. But that's they are the latest developments on arbitration clauses. So I think you've heard quite more than enough probably from myself and Callum for now. I'd like to turn this over now to Hugh and Russell to talk about some of their experiences post-appointment. Now, we've seen a lot, you know, particularly sort of post-Panama Papers, it's all across the press as usual, the offshore world being portrayed as, you know, consisting of fraudsters and then very little else, frankly. Hugh, does that measure up to your experience?
Yeah, I was taken by the presentation. I don't know how many of you saw it yesterday on the sociology of wealth managers. That was a wonderful cartoon, Offshore Inc., bad people doing bad things. We do have a fair share of bad people doing bad things, but typically speaking, people don't go offshore specifically for the purposes of creating frauds. In fact, in many cases, it's actually arguably a lot easier to construct a fraud with an onshore vehicle than it is with an offshore vehicle. The one exception I can think of, the primary exception, is where a fraudster seeks to encourage his victims to engage in a form of criminality in order to reduce their chances of them blowing a whistle and alerting the authorities. And the classic one for that is tax evasion. So if you can encourage your victims to believe that they can evade tax and put money in the vehicle and then you steal their money, it's going to take them a little bit longer to pluck up the courage to report you. But that's about it. So whilst we do have a fair share of bad people doing bad things and a fair share of fraud in relation to investment vehicles in particular, the frauds we see tend to be frauds designed to cover up trading failures. That's not to say they're not still frauds and they're not still illegal, but the number of schemes that are designed from the get-go as frauds are actually very rare indeed. I've been practicing in the Caribbean offshore market for 10 years, and I can count the number of deliberately designed frauds on the fingers of one hand. And that'd be two in Cayman, two in the BVI, and one elsewhere in the Caribbean. Quite rare. Russell, what's your experience in BVI?
Very, very similar, and because I'm an accountant, we'll start with some numbers. I got bored with the law, to be honest. there's about roughly 600,000 active companies and partnerships in the BVI, and just extrapolating a little bit, only about 0.005% of those are placed into some form of formal insolvency process every year because of some form of fraud. Broadly the same sort of percentage face an Norwich Pharmacal application, but that's harder to tell because often that happens, you know, on an ex parte behind closed doors basis. So quite a small percentage really. And as Hugh says, most of those entities have not been specifically set up to perpetrate a fraud. It's rather that a fraud has occurred as a result of management trying to deal with an issue or general bad management or ongoing poor trading. So I've got two entities I'm working on at the moment where there is clear fraud and they were clearly set up for that purpose. But overall, most of my liquidations have got, you know, were legitimate companies set up for legitimate purposes. That said, about 60% of my cases, I'm effectively acting as a forensic accountant trying to track down assets, deal with litigation, and unwind some form of inappropriate behavior. The balance of cases are real, you know, higher value, legitimate business collapses, which actually account for probably more of my overall revenue.
You know, Cayman's probably best known for collective investment vehicles such as hedge funds. I mean, at one point, I think Cayman was said to have incorporated 80% of the world's hedge funds were based there. It's a industry specialism for the jurisdiction. The thing about hedge funds is they don't really lend themselves awfully well to fraud. That's because a lot of the back office work is subcontracted out to professional administrators and the like. So the fraudster's ability to control the fraud tends to be more restricted. That's not to say frauds don't occur in hedge funds, they do, typically with a very strong-minded, strong and willful investment manager who can bully people or who creates artificial relationships with, for example, Madoff case would be a classic with fake or largely fake audit firm, for example. But when it does occur, these frauds almost always involve a fundamental failure by onshore actors rather than the offshore industry. And the fact that the entity was incorporated offshore is actually largely incidental to the fraud rather than a primary or central feature of it. And a lot of that comes back again to the genesis of the fraud, where the fraud arises incidental to the operation of the hedge fund rather than being its primary purpose. And the absolute classic, and the one you see most often, is trading failure. The investment manager makes some mistakes, he loses money. He's usually a person highly motivated by money and highly motivated by ego. He's too embarrassed to admit he's had a trading loss, so he just fluffs the figures a little. Because he knows, you know, he's got the ego to accompany that. He thinks, I'll make it back. I'll double down. Guess what? He doubles down and he loses that as well, and he doubles downs again. And the law of geometrical expansion is such that within a very short order of time, you've got a major fraud in your hands. So, for example, if you look at the Weavering case, which I'm involved in, that's a fraud which involves losses of over $600 million. But it started off as a trading failure. A guy who set up a hedge fund, and he was just basically really, really bad at trading equities and options, really bad. But what he was really good at is falsifying interest rate swaps. So $600 million, but didn't set off as a fraud. And again, the $600 million, you say, where did it go? A lot of it went back to people who invested early in the scheme, because what he was doing is inflating the value of the scheme, so people who redeemed out took a lot of the money. There's an old rule of thumb in the trade, actually, which says in a Ponzi scheme, or similar investment scheme collapse, approximately 80% of the money isn't actually stolen by the fraudster. It goes either in early redeemers or in the costs of running the fraud. The fraudster himself usually steals between 10 and 20%. We had another case actually involving BVI, the K1 scheme. We don't even know how much money was lost in there because the banks that were providing leverage refused to submit proofs of debt. They were that embarrassed. But we believe it's in excess of $1.5 billion run by a 60-year-old man whose only previous experience had been advising old-age pensioners in Germany on how to invest their nest eggs. And he led an extravagant lifestyle. He bought himself a nice jet, bought himself a house in Miami, a very popular destination for fraudsters for some reason. And he used to fly to Miami for the weekend from Frankfurt. But even if you add up all the money he stole and spent on his lifestyle, it's probably less than $100 million of that 1.6. The rest has all been recycled or lost on the markets. Russell, what views on BBI?
I think similar. I mean, we do have an alternative investment business in the BVI. It's not as strong as Cayman's business, but it's there and well regulated. And indeed, one story about the investors, the investment managers sort of taking lots of money out of the funds and flying over the world, rings true in a different way to a particular one I'm working on at the moment, where the investment manager has been so bad at trading and so bad at trying to cover up his losses that he's lost not as much, maybe $50 million, and is living in a one-bedroom studio flat in Switzerland at the moment. He was in the UK and never really got out of a one-bedroom flat. He was just that bad. He was just very good at convincing people to give him money. So sometimes you have to question the investors in the first place, really. But BVI's main focus, though, is really the incorporation of entities, as holdcos, propcos, and other general investment vehicles. And it's the use of these sort of holding company vehicles that actually does lend itself to the few instances of deliberately orchestrated fraud. And we will give you some juicy details later. But being frank and honest, it's easier to set up and use a company in the UK or the USA for such purposes than it is in the BVI. And I'm belaboring the point, we all are a little bit, but you know, there's two pertinent points that effectively defend offshore that, to a degree, and highlight that. The 2014 Global Shell Games Report found that 94% of BVI services companies are compliant with regulations that compel them to refuse to establish companies without proper documentation. Anyone want to guess at the percentage of UK companies who are compliant? 45%. Percentages for Delaware, anybody? We have a 30. Anyone else?
15.
15? No, 6%. So there you go. I mean, and the Financial Action Task Force, which is obviously a very serious organisation, actually ranks the BVI as more compliant with international regulatory standards than either the United States or the UK.
In Cayman, I suppose, as well as our predilection for hedge funds, we see an increasing amount of holding company structures as well. So the holding company has been set up for an internationally a diverse business or a business that's got assets in a difficult jurisdiction. Typically, that it can be established offshore, the holding company can be established offshore for tax purposes or for structural purposes in order to ease inward investment. So for example, People's Republic of China is a classic example whereby it's a lot easier having a BVI-led structure in terms of getting money into the system, but also in selling on your stake. I had an experience, for example, with a Peruvian entity, which went, the Cayman holding company went into liquidation. You might say, what's a Peruvian entity doing with a holding company in the Cayman Islands? And the answer was because the two American investors wanted to buy this Peruvian company, but they wanted to exit at some point. And for them to buy directly into the Peruvian entity and then exit in 3 years would be enormously complicated from a regulatory perspective. A lot easier to sell their shares in the Cayman Holding Company when the time came to exit. And we see very similar issues in relation to Chinese entities in particular with the BVI. I think you'd probably agree with that, Russell.
I'd completely agree with that. And as you say, particularly BVI is used for that because of that need for an effective, neutral jurisdiction. And that's why BVI has been so heavily used over the last few decades. And this is the last of these points, I promise. But the only offshore jurisdiction that has more incorporations than the BVI is Delaware. And in 2014, there were approximately 169,000 companies formed in Delaware. So there you go. Probably about half that in the BVI that year.
Well, what that means, of course, from a holding company perspective, is that an offshore insolvency practitioner's job is not always or even most often about chasing dirty money. Quite often it can be about realizing financial assets held around the world, and sometimes about managing a trading companies that are onshore, that are simply owned by the offshore entity. The Peruvian case I refer to, for example, that Peruvian entity was an electricity distribution company, actively trading. And so the challenge for the insolvency practitioner was how to manage those trading activities, manage the risk around them, finance the vehicle, because the alternative of shutting down the electricity distribution company, which was a monopoly supplier, would have cut off the electricity to 200,000 people in Peru, which is clearly, you know, going to be problematic. So, as I say, it's not all, well, certainly for them anyway, it's not always about the fraudsters and the dirty money. Sometimes it's about more complex issues of maintaining control and indeed investigating assets. And Russell?
Typically that's very same again in the BVI, very similar for large liquidations. A good example is something like Victory Life actually. And that Guy mentioned in his opening remarks. This was the BVI's first regulated insurance company, although in reality its products were more akin to a tax neutral investment opportunity for its policyholders. It fell afoul of the regulator. Its regulatory compliance was shoddy, should we say at best. And that led to one of a petition by the fourth person that can petition in the BVI, the FSC. Now, on appointment, we had 5,000 policyholders, approximately 100 million euros under management. But then each policy had a fairly unique set of assets, to the point that actually many of the policyholders had put their own assets, including things like gold, shares in BVI companies that own their houses, all sorts of crazy things, a big pile of mahogany. into the policy. So that's all fine in itself. The only problem is that the documents made it very clear, and had to for tax reasons, that the assets were solely owned by the company. So how do you distribute out someone's house to 5,000 people? Doesn't really work. So that causes quite a few challenges. We had more challenges because this was effectively a company operated from Sweden, selling its products across the Scandinavian market. And if you try and do insolvency in the Nordic countries, you cannot be recognized as a non-Nordic insolvency practitioner. So again, it becomes a negotiation. It becomes acting effectively as directors and trying to get the job done. It leads to some very challenging situations.
As I mentioned earlier, control and investigation are the primary challenges in such a situation. And as again was mentioned yesterday, it's national boundaries that create the problem. Once you cross a national boundary, you're into a different jurisdiction, sometimes a completely different system of law, quite apart from a different jurisdiction's laws, and it causes problems. So you can have all the powers, statutory powers of investigation control you like in your domestic jurisdiction offshore, but whether they actually apply or can be seen to apply in the jurisdiction where the assets are can be down to a matter of whether that other jurisdiction is prepared to recognize your statutory authority as a liquidator. Sometimes it's easier to exercise your control by acting as the shareholder rather than as the liquidator, and using the governance powers you have over the subsidiaries, for example, to either obtain assets or to investigate the affairs of the company. And giving you an example, again, turning back to my South American electricity company, that was a civil law jurisdiction. So they would simply, to get my appointment as liquidator recognized there would have required a diplomatic process, right? Interjurisdictional diplomatic application, which was taken between 6 to 12 months to process. And that's just even assuming they even accepted it. And in the meantime, what's happening to my famous 200,000 people without any electricity in a desert in Peru? So in that case, what we did was we changed the articles of the company by acting as the shareholder in order to change the composition of the board of directors and to limit the directors' powers. So that basically, the directors could trade the company on a day-to-day basis but couldn't do anything extreme without our authorization and approval. And these kind of approaches are quite similar for Chinese companies in particular, where for a foreign appointed liquidator to try to assert his authority qua liquidator in the People's Republic is a criminal offence, which would, if the liquidator was foolish enough to set foot there, he'd end up going to jail. And I mean, BVI is classic for Chinese companies, Russell.
That's right. I mean, historically, and still very much today, a huge amount of inward investment into China comes via BVI companies in Hong Kong. Another great example, Titan Group Investment, Topco of China's largest oil and gas storage facilities. And to try and give you an example of the size of just one of these facilities, imagine a footprint the size of Miami Airport and cover it in oil and gas storage silos, and times that by four, and you've got four different facilities, which suddenly we're in control of, albeit at the Topco level. You work through the structure, you change the boards, either by changing the articles or by just your rights as a shareholder. We had to change a Bermudan board. That one we just flooded. We literally had to flood the board with 7 or 8 KPMG people so we could then take control of the board and deal with the rest of the structure. And then you get down to the WFOEs, the wholly owned foreign enterprises in China, and you can choose to either just act as a shareholder or potentially step onto the board. One always has to be careful what one does there. But the big issue, of course, is you get control, or some form of control, and you think, yeah, it's great, I'm on the boards, I'm in charge of the shareholders, but then you get these legal representatives in China, and very specifically the CHOPs. So the CHOP in China is literally a wooden CHOP with symbols on it that represent your company, and it has to go on any formal documentation. It's effectively a supercharged company seal, and the location and the protection of those CHOPs is paramount to running any Chinese enterprise. But getting someone to take control of those CHOPs that's not the guy that already has them, or not the current legal representative, is very difficult because there's huge liabilities associated with them. In this instance, in this particular example, on one of the sites, the CHOPs had been removed by a creditor who was trying to seek their own action, and the financial officer, the chief financial officer on site, was so concerned about her reputation and her potential legal ramifications, she had to be talked off of the roof because the chops went missing. So that's how serious a thing it is in China. And so how nerve-wracking it can be as a liquidator going into that situation. And then you've got to deal with all the local cultural issues as well. So you're getting into what's really a negotiation. You've got to keep the local banks happy. You've got to educate them about restructuring and insolvency and what you're doing. You've got to keep the local government on side because they've normally guaranteed all these debts in the first place. And they've got to deal with a workforce when it's made redundant. So on the one hand, you've got a risk that any of these local stakeholders might just try and take your hundreds of million dollars of assets and deal with it themselves. On the other hand, they kind of want to work with you, but don't really get what you do. So it's a very interesting and challenging situation.
I heard a story recently. I don't think Hugh and Russell know this, but they'll enjoy it. One of their competitor firms, who I don't think are in the room today, but one of the liquidators from their Singapore office went on a case over to China for, I think it was a two-day business trip, but he'd somehow had upset the local judge in China. So when he arrived, the Chinese judge ordered that his passport be taken away, and he was effectively confined to his hotel room for 6 weeks before they finally let him go and get back to his family. So it's a pretty sharp example of the risk you take as a liquidator in operating in the PRC.
I suppose one of my favourite examples is Switzerland, where Switzerland's a nightmare for insolvency practitioners, foreign insolvency practitioners. If you've got any assets whatsoever or undertaking in Switzerland and you have a formal appointment outside Switzerland, the Swiss immediately say, well, we have to have our separate mini bankruptcy, as they call it, in Switzerland, and it has to be conducted by a Swiss because we don't trust you foreign devils. And you don't get to choose that person. So if it's a financial institution or a bank, the regulator gets appointed, and that's if you're lucky, right? Because if it's an ordinary company, it goes to the local bankruptcy officer, who's typically used to dealing with moms and pops and the corner store, and then he's expected to deal with cross-border insolvency, and that can be chaotic. And if you try to obtain information from inside Switzerland, you're committing a criminal offence. If you try to project your authority into Switzerland, you're committing a criminal offence. So you end up in a sort of a moral suasion dialogue with your mini-bankruptcy trustee and try to persuade him as to the appropriate course of action. Conversely, if you have a voluntary or liquidation or a proceeding out with a formal court appointment, then the Swiss don't recognise you at all, which rather perversely acts in your favour, because then you can act with the full authority of the company. And at that point, any Swiss resident director or service provider who doesn't actually discharge his duties, fiduciary duties properly, is committing a criminal offence. So if they fail to give you the information, they're committing a criminal offence. It's somewhat bizarre and interesting scenario. And of course, Cayman being a British overseas territory, it's really interesting seeing the comparison with the UK. It's comparatively easy to get a Cayman liquidation or a court appointment recognised in the UK. And that then enables you to use UK law or Cayman law as you see fit. So, for example, I have a case at the moment where we've frozen all the assets of an individual who's suspected of having misappropriated company funds and have interviewed him in the UK using UK law. At the same time, I'm one of the liquidators in the Saad case, where the investigatory provisions in Cayman are quite restricted, and we were up against the auditors, who are a big four firm, who claim to be a Bermudan partnership. So we went after them in Bermuda instead. And we won at first instance, and we won an appeal, and then we got handed our head on a plate by the Privy Council, who said that it was wholly improper for the Bermudan court to have given us greater powers in Bermuda than we had in Cayman. Now, that Bermudan partnership was the ultimate beneficial owner, if you like, was the UK firm. And if I could have demonstrated that and gone after the UK firm, I'd have had virtually unfettered powers of interviewing, examination of them under UK law. So, again, it's an interesting, somewhat perverse result. Russell, you've had some experiences in Australia, I suppose, another Commonwealth jurisdiction. You want to tell us about this?
Yeah, and actually, slightly more positive experience in that we had a situation, and I'm going to tell you about a fraud, and one that was a deliberate fraud, because it is offshore alert after all. Now, it wasn't someone trying to defraud, you know, little old ladies of their tea and biscuit money. It was actually very sophisticated investors being defrauded by a very sophisticated, or what looked like a sophisticated currency trading platform. But really, it was just completely virtual. No trades were actually booked with anybody. People thought they were making a profit or a loss, but the chap behind it all, a Pakistani national, was just pocketing the money or transferring it elsewhere. So it was a BVI company, which invested into a Dubai-based entity, which was regulated in Dubai. But that cash, say, was diverted. But the individual we found behind this was traced down to Australia, where he was also trying to cover up a very similar fraud he was carrying on with an Australian company. We had I should also mention he's wanted by the authorities in Italy and in Switzerland. He's in trouble in Belize and somewhat differently in Pakistan. And he's also used UK and US companies to perpetrate frauds in the last decade. But we tracked this guy down to Australia. We had a private investigator following him and his second or third wife. I mean concurrent as well, by the way. I'm not sure if that's fraudulent or not in Pakistan, but anyway, there we go. And we're following this guy around, and simultaneously we're seeking in the Australian courts some recognition and public examination orders based on a BVI court letter of request that we had sent from the BVI court. Australia's membership of that small club of countries who signed up to the UNCITRAL model law of insolvency, and then using Australia's Corporation Acts. We think actually, and we got those orders. We also got an order that his passport be seized, which was quite exciting. We think it was a first in Australia because the only nexus we had to Australia at all was the fact that this chap was there. But the court was quite sympathetic and we got these orders. So great, we've got our PI following him around. The regulator, you know, requests a meeting, he attends the meeting. The regulator tells him he has to hand over his passport. He says, well, I'm awfully sorry, I've got to have a medical procedure tomorrow. Can I just keep my passport for a couple of days? Regulator, thank you, Mr. Australian regulator, says, oh, well, that sounds perfectly legitimate, of course you can. So then our PI then follows the fraud perpetrator to his house, effectively watches him pack his bags, watch him go to the airport and get straight on a plane to the UAE. You're not allowed to follow people in the UAE, it's illegal, so we lost him for a bit at that point. But what did we do next? We went to some different courts. We went to the DFIC courts, which is the Dubai International Finance Center. It's a free trade zone in Dubai, for those of you who don't know it. So we went there to try and get the Dubai company's bank account records, and did something quite crafty, because the Dubai bank was not based in DFIC, but it had a branch within DFIC. And that allowed us to use the Dubai court to get the bank records from that Dubai, or the DFIC court to get the bank records from Dubai. And again, you can only do that if it's a branch operation. If it was a separate legal entity, we wouldn't have got it. But that allowed us to go a lot further on this case, led to seeking recognition in the UK, examinations of various corporate records there. And it's ongoing, but hopefully we will get somewhere with this individual in the end.
I just think of that story of the chap flying away with his passport. It reminds me of the early stages of the Saad case, in which when it was in receivership, and one of the assets was an Airbus 320, which was parked in Bahrain, where it had been attached by the receivers. And the chap behind the setup said to the authorities, well, this thing needs to have a Type C check, you know, to stay in its regulatory compliance, and for that we need to do a test flight. And you see what's coming next, right? So rather than pick a crew of their own choosing, the receiver said, yeah, that would be fine. And of course, the plane took off from Bahrain and just kept going. I think it's still out there somewhere. and I suspect the PIs following your chat was probably accompanied by all the PIs from his various wives as well.
Very good. We had a bit of a late start, so I think we're going to have to cut it short there. I'm sure everyone's keen to get to the Panama Papers panel. I don't want to keep you from that. But just quickly, are there any questions for any of the panelists today? Yes.
Just sort of a general question from a U.S. lawyer's perspective to kind of understand the context, and this goes to your explanation. explanations about, I guess, your dueling justices. So in your jurisdictions, you would follow the UK law, the common law, unless you have a particular law in your jurisdiction that, I suppose, conflicts. But when you're mentioning, for example, if you're in the Cayman, you're mentioning, you know, a decision out of the BVI, are you looking at that as sort of possibly being persuasive? It has no precedential value, but you also consider your sister jurisdictions' laws regarding matters that are sort of similar in consideration?
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, I think it's the same for Cayman and BVI. The English authorities, assuming they're based on common law and not specific statutes that don't apply locally, are the most persuasive. They're not technically binding, but they're persuasive. Decisions of other Commonwealth courts similarly are persuasive, perhaps slightly less so, but will generally be followed. But I think in the example Callum gave, these two particular judges were never going to see eye to eye and agree with each other on the law. But absolutely, other Commonwealth decisions are of persuasive authority. Very good. Well, we're just a little over time, so thank you all for coming. And if I could just ask you to thank my fellow panelists in the usual way.